gods of the Old Testament. Remember when Israel turned away from God, what happened? They turned to other gods. Well, what is America doing? We have turned away from God. What's happening? These gods are coming in on us. Is God a Baal and Ashtaroth? I think one of the worst ones that's coming is this God of Moloch. Remember the God of Moloch? That was where they put the children through the fire. Well, that's going to be, that is the God of abortion. I mean, we got women out here demonstrating in the street wanting abortion. And then people wonder, well, why is all this bad stuff happening to our country? Because when you kick God out, what have you got? Basically, that's what a lot of the politicians want. They do not want God, anything to do with Jesus Christ. Have you noticed? Let's just go back 50 years. How rapid all this stuff has come about. And right now it's accelerating on faster. He deals with all this stuff. I mean, it permeates the whole society. Goes through it all. And the only solution to this is to turn to God. That's the only way you're going to get rid of it. The only other way you're going to get rid of these spirits is in the future when Jesus Christ casts them all into the lake of fire. We'll have to deal with them until that day. So we're going to start the book of James today. James, he was the oldest half-brother of Jesus. And he was the leader of the church at Jerusalem. This book was written, depending on who you read after, it was written somewhere between AD 46 to 62. First book of the New Testament that was written. Now, James, he is writing to the Jews. You know, Paul, his writings were to Gentiles. And so, it is said that James' knees looked like camel's knees because he stayed on his knees and fasted. You just don't see nobody like that. We have got so much going in our lives today. We're pushing, even the devoted Christians are pushing God further and further away. This has got to be done. We got to see to this. We got to go here. This is something that I stumbled past about this. This is something that has never been taught in this area, to my knowledge, the power of spirit. And then people think, well, there's no spirits today. They're all gone. But see, these spirits, they come in and they affect your mind. Put thoughts in your mind. That's the reason why we got all this stuff going on in America today. Chapter 1, verse 1, he said, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greeting. In a lot of Paul's letters, he'll give a long greeting. James doesn't do that. I mean, he gets right into it. He said, verse 2 says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. That's something that's hard to do. I mean, coming against us, we count it all joy. But you got to understand, when you do that, that is a sign you have the Jesus Christ as Lord. Because if you're up with him, he ain't gonna bother his own. Well, the word joy in the Greek means cheerfulness, calm delight. That's another thing you don't find in a lot of people today. Calm delight. Everybody's upset about something. Matthew 5, 11 and 12. Yeah. We're getting up to see road rage that's coming so much today. You know, somebody just accidentally cut somebody off, or maybe they're not going as fast as you, and somebody pull up beside them and shoot them. I mean, it's just insane. Matthew 5, 11 and 12. Jesus speaking here. He said, blessed are you when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manners of evil against you falsely for my sake. Listen, rejoice and be exceedingly glad. For great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Right. We'll go to Philippians. Philippians 1, 27 and 8. Only let your conversation be as it becomes the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that you stand fast in one spirit, in one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. Now listen to this. And in nothing terrified by your adversaries, which is to them an evident token of perdition, but to you of salvation, and that of God. Paul was saying here that these people that are coming against you for your faith, it is an evident sign that they'll never see Jesus Christ. People don't understand that today. You know, well, we just believe it this way, and we're the only ones that are going. That Jesus said this in the 7th chapter of Matthew. The only ones that are going are the ones that do the will of the Father. And that's the reason why we need to do some studying. Find out what is the will of the Father. But he said, you have diverse temptations. The word diverse means various or manifold. Temptation means a putting to proof or an adversary. We have, as I said a while ago, we see all this book today coming to pass. I have never seen the church in my lifetime, and I'm getting old enough, I've seen quite a bit. I have never seen the church in such a fact as it is today. I mean, let's just put it down to this church here. And it's the same in other places. The people that used to, I mean, they were eager to get here. Now they're not even here. They're gone. They're doing this. They're doing that. But Jesus said, those that endure to the end, the same shall be saved. People don't believe that. Oh, I've been saved, and that's... No, he said, you endure to the end, you're going to come be with me. But see, as I've said so many times, religion has dumbed the church down. Religion has told the church, you don't have to do all these things. You just do it the way we tell you to. But he said, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. The word patience also means that cheerful endurance, consistency. As I said a minute ago, you don't find nobody today that are very many. There's a few. I believe it this way. I believe if the rapture happened right now, you wouldn't miss many people. That's a hard thing to say, but that's the truth. I mean, they have other gods, you know. In the Old Testament, you find out that Israel turned away from God, they went to serve another god. What has happened to people today? We're serving other gods, mostly materialism. Our money, or houses, or cars, or this, that, and the other. Whatever it happens to be. Paul said, but let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. The word entire there means complete in every part. Now, Jesus told us, when the Holy Ghost has come, he will teach us all things. Well, then if we are truly following him, he will show us what he wants us to do through the Spirit. You know that? We have got too many people that look to other people to tell them what God wants them to do. And that's wrong. I've got a job to do. You've got a job to do. Yeah. And I've got to have the Holy Ghost to tell me what's my part. Because I can only do what I've got to do. If I try to do what you've got to do, I will guarantee you I'll make a mess out of it. Yeah. Verse 5. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. James goes on in a little later on in the letter, he tells us, we have not because we ask not. Everything you get from God is voice activated. You've got to ask. People say, well, God knows what I need. If he wants me to have it, he'll give it to me. That's not the way it works. He knows you need it, and so therefore you got to ask for it. It's just like a parent. A parent wants to hear from the child, but God wants to hear from us. The word wisdom there means the knowledge and the practice of godly and upright living. And upbraideth means to defame or to rail at. In other words, God, if I ask God for something, God's not going to rail at me and say, well, you ought to know better than that. No, he says, I'll teach you what you need to know. A lot of people have a misunderstanding of God. God is not one to hammer us over the head about something. He leads and he guides. Now the devil's the one hitting the head with something. He'll try to force you to do something. God won't ever force you. See, we were founded as a godly nation, America. And God could have forced us to stay that way if he wanted to, but he don't. Those that come to him have to come willingly. Yeah. Verse 6 says, but let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. There are so many people there, and I know each and every one of us see people like this. They're just like this. They go one way one way for a little while, then they go another way. But you have got to you have got to be like Jesus. When we studied it in the book of Mark, it said he set his face to go to Jerusalem. That's what we have to do. We have to have a determination that we're going to do what God has called us to do. You can't believe it one way today and another way tomorrow. And you take people that we call them church hoppers. They go to this church today and that church tomorrow, and they say this, you know, with all these different denominations and different beliefs and everything, all they're going to be is confused. Verse 7 said, "For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord." See, we have got to have a consistent faith if we receive what God has for us. As I said, we can't believe one thing today and something else tomorrow. Something there, Carlos. There's very few churches in the area that I know anything about that really know what true worship is. Yeah. True worship is not singing. Songs that people sing are actually not praise to God. It's all about us. Yeah. Look, there's so many of these songs start out, "When I." It ain't about I, it's about Him. Verse 8 said, "A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways." That double-minded man that also means two-spirited, vacillating. This person lives one life for himself and one for God. People like that are nomads going here and there. We can't be double-minded about anything. We need to, in our personal life, we have to be single-minded if we accomplish anything. And so, being double-minded in the kingdom of God, you know you're not going to get anywhere. Verse 9. "Let the brother of low degree rejoice that he is exalted, but the rich in that he is made low, because as the flower of the grass, he shall pass away." 1 Peter 5:5-6. Like, 1 Peter 5:5, "Likewise, you younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another, and be clothed with humility, for God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time." This is another thing we're not finding people. We're not finding, even in the church, we're not finding a lot of humility anymore. We're finding too much pride in the church. And God hates the pride. And so I think that would tell us why a lot of the church world is not growing like and doing the things that Jesus said we should be doing. For the sun is no sooner risen with a burning heat, but it withereth the grass, and the flower thereof falleth, and the grace and the fashion of it perish. So also shall the rich man fade away in his ways. I think we could all agree, if you're trusting in your money right now, you're trusting in the wrong thing. I mean, you know, we had the stock market one day this week went down over 1,200 points. Look at the billions and billions of dollars that was lost just out there that one day. And James, I'm jumping ahead, but James will tell us in the 5th chapter, there is coming a worldwide financial collapse. One day, I don't know when it is, but it's coming. The only thing that is going to remain true is Jesus Christ. Paul said, my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. I mean, all this worldly stuff, it's coming to an end one day. Well, blessed is the man that endures temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. The word temptation there in the Greek means trials with beneficial purpose and effort and effect. Did you know the easiest way to learn something is through your mistakes, your trials? I mean, you know, if you hit your thumb with a hammer, you're going to learn right quick. You don't want to do that no more. So, and so it is even in our spiritual life. We make mistakes. I don't care who you are, you're going to make mistakes. But, as we've just read, God's not going to hit you over the head with the Bible just because you made a mistake. If you say, God, I repent of this thing, God will show you what to do next when you missed it. And, you know, I think sometimes that we go through things, the beneficial purpose of that is that we can help somebody else when they go through it. So I don't care what you went through with, but if somebody else is going through it, if you haven't went through what they went through, you don't know how to help them. All is not lost when we go through all these trials and troubles that we have in this life. Verse 13 said, that no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempted he any man. People have a misconception of God, I guess you'd say. They say, well, everything comes from God. No. Evil comes from the devil. Good and perfect gifts come from God. You're going to see that in a few minutes here. 14 said, but every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. The word enticed means bait. Something has baited you to get you to do whatever you've done. Yeah. But you know, we always think of this word lust, you know, as sex or something. Now, you could lust after a new car or a new house or something. take a little kid in a toy store. He's just throwing a fit. He thinks he's not going to be able to live unless he gets that toy. But what happens? You buy the kid the toy. What happens? 3 or 4 days later, you find it laid out there somewhere in the grass. And that's the way we are in life. We get these things and we think we got to have them, and we get them, and then we're not satisfied with it. Thing said, then when lust is conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. The basic meaning of this word is separation. Romans 6 and 23. Romans 6, verse 23. Paul said here, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. You know the old saying, you know, sin will always take you further than you wanted to go. And that's a true statement. It will. Yeah. Today, how many people today will die of a drug overdose in America? I mean, the first drug that they took, I mean, they was enjoying it. But then they got a hold of them and finally it killed them. It's happening every day now. And it, not only drugs, but you name it. Anything that's out of the will of God, it will at least separate you from God. If they don't actually kill you physically. Verse 16 says, do not err, my beloved brother. That word error also means you can be deceived. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above. It cometh down from the Father of life, with whom there is no variableness of turning, even shadow of turning. That word variable means to move. This, as we keep talking about, God is just like a human father. A human father wants the best that their child can have. And God wants us to do the same way. But it's just the same way with a natural father. He wants that child to follow his leadership. When he says don't do it, that's what he means, don't do it. Satan says, of his own will begat he us with the word of truth, that we should be the kind of first fruit of his creatures. 1 Peter 1 and 23. Peter said, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. We are bought with the word. We are bought with the spirit. For somebody to be born again, they've got to hear some kind of word. It may just be one word. They've got to hear some words. Where it comes to pass. So we'll pick up again.